This evening, Paul will talk about his love for Morandi and the display we have at the museum. But the Estorick Collection, probably most of you would have been visited it, has an holding of around 28 works by Giorgio Morandi. We have 18 etchings and 10 drawings. And it is a very important part of our collection. It's probably one of the most loved part of the collection, and in fact we always have a set of complaints if they're not around, but also it is very interesting to see for us how the interest and the love for these artists developed throughout the last 20 something years that we've been around. And I think it's a part of the conversation we have with Paul is the fact that actually his love for the artist has been shown to from parallel to the growing of the museum. In fact, is Paul and I, we talked about this before in the previous talks. Paul and I, we met very early on when I started as assistant curator at the collection, and the conversation has grown regarding. For me, it was very interesting to see how an artist and a British person was interested in the works and how influenced many artists. And then some of the conversation sort of ended up in this the exhibition we had in 2006. And maybe Paul, you can chat the talk to us a bit about how. I remember you coming to me with these ideas, but how did it develop in for you?
Yeah, but thank you, Roberta, and welcome everyone to tonight. As Roberta said, my involvement sort of with the Estorick started really when it's opened, because my children went to school next door, and so there was this very strange moment where one of the artists that I most adore. You know, there was a collection of his on, you know, on my way on the school run. It was, you know, quite exceptional. And over the years, I've written a number of catalogue essays for the Estorick, for various shows. And I began to sort of get a sense that Morandi was one of those artists that we refer to as an artist's artist. Someone who has had a really quite a profound effect on a lot of artists in the way they work, and often in quite surprising ways. And I put it to Roberta that it would be interesting to try and curate an exhibition which looked at the influence that I felt Morandi had over a few generations of British art. And I wanted to frame this exhibition around conversations. As you'll probably get sick to death of me talking about conversations and dialogue and things like that. But I wanted to set up very simple juxtapositions of key works by a British artist with a key work by Morandi. And in a way, let them talk to each other and suggest you know, particular things. This was the juxtaposition that I made with my own work here, relating the quality of Morandi's cross-hatching with my use of the computer halftone dot, and also my relationship with very ordinary everyday objects and Morandi's still lives, which, you know, are made of similar. Could we have the next slide? This was, I think, you know, one of the most interesting juxtapositions in the show. Michael Craig Martin is not someone that you would immediately think of as being a great fan of Morandi's work. I mean, he was accused of almost being having a demonic presence on the destruction of English painting. You know, with his support of Damien Hirst and other of the Goldsmiths crowd. But in fact, Michael Craig Martin has a deep understanding of Morandi's work, and he made this painting specially for the show. And we juxtaposed it with this still life, which I think we borrowed from Edinburgh, if I remember. And you can see that, you know, Morandi is using his sort of library of everyday objects in a very similar way to the way Craig Martin is sort of cataloguing the everyday objects that we surround ourselves with. So I thought this was a very nice, juxtaposition. And
well, also I also think is that, and it's probably where we can start talking about your personal experience and what you have on display at the moment at the collection, is the fact that actually Morandi make us look in a completely different way to the normal objects. And I think is that that was very obvious throughout the exhibition and generally also what you do. So there's things we still surround us, but if you look long enough, and you can see so many things behind it. Obviously for Morandi, we had so many ideas that it could be, there are buildings, there could be not only objects, but also people, a conversation, but still definitely, at least definitely was, to make a look at the normal mundane objects like bottles and
balls
in a completely different way. So maybe you can talk a bit about what is going to be, what your conversation with your objects during the last couple of years.
Yeah, well, just before going to that, I think that just stay with this with this slide. One of the things is it's quite easy to kind of think of Morandi's bottles and objects now when we look at them as something that you might find in an antique shop. And they have a certain, charm in that way. But in fact, these are really everyday objects of no value at all. You know, the coffee tin, the jar, the box, the bottles, we're not looking at the kind of materials, for example, that are in a Dutch still life, where, you are being, your senses are being ravished by, the textures and quality of wealth, substance, texture, and things like this. Morandi's objects are very much almost like, peasant objects. Could we go on to them? I suppose when... that's it, brilliant. When Roberta kindly invited me to, be part of the rehang and to look at Morandi's work, it made me actually sort of think about some of the comparisons between the two of us. And I don't mean that in an arrogant way, because you have to decide on value and quality. But I suppose lockdown, where this project was really conceived, made me think of a lot of kind of connections. I mean, for example, Morandi rarely traveled. He lived, all his life in Bologna. He had a little country house in Grisana, just outside of Bologna, about an hour outside. I think he left Italy once. His studio was a far cry from, the grand studios that one normally associates with artists. It was his bedroom come studio with his etching press at the end of the bed. And that was in the apartment that he shared with his three spinster sisters. He worked very much primarily from everyday objects, which he'd find in the local bric-a-brac shop, or landscapes that he'd observe from the balcony of his house in Grisana, or from, just little sort of, bits around the town. And there was also an aspect of Morandi's work, which Roberta has just sort of touched on, is that it also is a reflection on the city of Bologna itself. Bologna is characterized by having colonnades which enable you to crisscross the city without getting wet or sunburnt. And also these towers, which you can see here, which were built by families as a sign of prestige, a number of which have fallen down, which I suppose is a kind of poetic notion for the passing of time and vanity. And you can see in a way that landscape, cityscape echoed in, for example, a painting like this of a still life of 1947. And if we could just go back one slide. And then for me, in terms of lockdown, instead of having the self-imposed lockdown of Morandi, mine, along with everybody else in the country, was imposed by government. My studio's at home, so there's that commonality. Over lockdown, it was only occasional local travel. I think my work is embedded within the idea of London, and there are echoes of that that comes through. And I suppose also I started to reflect on poetry as a reflective process in terms of understanding what was going on through lockdown. And I suppose here's on the right is a corner of Miranda's studio with all his rubbish gathering. And on the left are two views of some of the things that I was making in my studio. Whereas Morandi used found objects primarily, the objects that I started working from were either made or cast. And they tended to be in miniature. So I was almost like retreating into a kind of more private, introspective world through lockdown.
And maybe we can sort of talk about, obviously from here is, we will see again in the finished works, but obviously the scale, because Morandi, the scale is the real scale. Here you play certain objects that are in a small scale, but some of them are the original size. So is that, maybe you can touch upon that?
But yeah, if we could just go on to the next slide, that I can use that to illustrate. I mean, for example, in one of the things that always intrigued me about Morandi is this, is his use of scale. I mean, this is a tiny etching. It's only about, I think, 15, 20 centimeters across. And yet you actually feel as if you're seeing a cityscape. In one's mind, it becomes much, much bigger than it is in the flesh. And I suppose I was quite drawn to the idea of working with, quite small miniature objects, but a way to actually make them seem as if they were much grander, or if they were kind of rooms or things like that. And I also wanted to jar the scale so that some things seem correct, and others seem not so. And I suppose that was an attempt to try and create a sense of unease, which I felt very much through lockdown. And you can see how those sets of relationships that are set up in Morandi's still life are echoed in this landscape, rather beautiful landscape. And I suppose with the fact that Morandi would view the landscape through binoculars, that had the effect of taking out the foreground. And so what one deals with is a kind of flattened middle ground. And that's something that I became very interested in. I think also there is I suppose that, without trying to put too fine a point on it, I think there's something very poignant and relevant in Morandi's work in terms of what's happening in Glasgow at the moment with the climate crisis. In a work like this, I think Morandi is setting up a kind of set of relationships between man and nature, between, you know, the houses and the trees, and that each thing has its own importance and is kind of embedded together. And I think that if we have a kind of message coming, you know, that needs to come from Glasgow, it's the fact that we have to think of the world as a contained unit where everything can affect one another. So I think in a way, in a poetic way, he's proposing a kind of harmony with nature, a kind of coexistence.
I was going to ask, obviously you talked about the studio being interested in what is already was there, but do you think was a choice by you would have sort of naturally evolved in looking at into everyday object as a focusing within the studio, also was very much from you couldn't do landscapes, so in a sense, because you were so how much part of the lockdown sort of played?
Yeah. Well, that's an interesting question, because I suppose in a way lockdown just intensified my experience. I mean, I've always worked with objects. I feel very sort of self-conscious working with figures and landscape. So in a way, all my work has been very much concerned with objects and our relationship to them and things like that. I suppose something that is also worth just mentioning is that one of the really interesting things for me about lockdown was being able to, have limited social life, limited travel and things like this, which actually meant that I became much more introspective. And I could also concentrate in a way that, isn't possible when you're in the daily grind.
And that also comes out as a positive, which is quite interesting.
And that also connects with the way that Morandi would go about working on his still lives, that he had two or three shelves in his bedroom arranged at different heights and to receive the light at different times of the day. And he would spend quite a long time arranging his objects, leaving them around, letting dust gather on them and things like that, before finally committing to actually working from them. So in some ways, there was that kind of meditative state where, you know, one often feels that the actual painting or the etching is done relatively quickly, but is that a simulation of the image and the juggling around, moving everything beforehand, that actually becomes very important.
Kind of the relationship between the painter and the object. So it was also a kind of a respect. Morandi has always been, despite they are sort of everyday objects or not particularly expensive or anything like that, but it was still, he actually was a relationship to the respect of them. And is that one thing that just came to my mind, is that Morandi had a respect for lots of things, like for his paintbrushes. And is I think is when he used them, until obviously probably was a different kind of time when paintbrushes were less disposable than they are now, but you used to sort of put them in sort of put them away. You never throw them away. So they actually buried them. So there's that kind of a respect and kind of relationship with the objects, even if they're not inanimate, but there was a sort of like a, and the time spending in the conversation, as we said before, a conversation with them, what the relationship with the light, with the shelf between each other, it was as important as the act of painting.
Yeah, that's a very good point, Roberta. And I think the another aspect of that is that I think that one of the things that, you know, Morandi's art does is it says that everything can be important if it's in the right place. You know, it's not an object's importance is not determined by its material value or even its intrinsic beauty. Morandi says that, you know, any old bit of crap can actually work if it's in the right place. And also, as if you see a lot of Morandi's pictures, you'll see the same objects cropping up over and over again. And they become a little bit like kind of family groupings, you know, and little sort of, you know, parties where, you know, different groups are assembled to see what happens. The other thing is that the colour has this echo of Bologna, of the, you know, the painted houses and things like that, and the plaster work. So it's all kind of quite embedded. And, you know, this is just an adorable little etching. And it's worth just mentioning, you know, something about the way that this plate would have been made. When I was a student, I was led to believe that Morandi's etchings represented lots of hard physical work. But in fact, it's the opposite, that he would make the drawing directly onto the through the wax onto the etching plate. And then before etching it, he would do a test plate where he could determine exactly how long it needed to be in the acid to keep the integrity of each line. So in a way, like a photographer testing for an exposure in the darkroom. And in an image like this, if this had been etched for another minute, it would have lost all its sparkle because the lines would have actually merged together and broken. So, you know, I suppose this is another instance where time comes into Morandi's thinking and making, which I suppose for me in lockdown, I suddenly had a different amount of time, which was very welcome.
Also, if we go, obviously, this is one of your works, finally, we come to it. And it's actually, I think it's maybe before you start anything else, maybe you could speak of your technique is very different from Morandi and also very, very similar, as you explained, but maybe you can give us a little bit of an insight on what is this on the photograph, but when they come and see in the galleries.
Well, this work began life as objects that I'd made and arranged on a table, and then photographed, and then that was then taken through the computer. I introduced a half-tone dot, which is something I've used a lot, which is, I suppose, a kind of recognition that in printmaking, the way that a photograph enters printmaking is via the half-tone dot. You know, if you look at a press photograph under a magnifying glass, you'll see that it breaks up into these dots. And I suppose for me, these dots have become as important as Morandi's cross-hatching. and then from this print was made in quite a few layers, and then I reduced it down to three layers with different kinds of dot. And I had laser cut wood blocks made for each color. And then the grape stalks, that was a lino cut that I made. and they were then printed one on top of the other to create this kind of, what I hope is a sense of, an intense sense of surface and having to look through the surface to try and discern what's going on behind. So in some ways this you know, both connects with, you know, Morandi's cross-hatching, but also with Marcel Duchamp's idea of encouraging the viewer to construct the image in their head. So if we go on to the next one, you can see this. This is a beautiful Morandi drawing. And I think you, as I was mentioning before about the kind of surface in my own work, there's a wonderful sense of surface in this drawing, that you really feel the touch of the pencil on the paper. And Morandi was quite a big man. And so this, you know, there is something sort of rather delicately ungainly about the way that he is sort of just touching the surface with the pencil. And I like the way that even his signature and date actually become formal elements in the drawing itself.
No, sorry, I interrupted you. The signature often is a hank of the old composition as well.
Also exactly.
My other thoughts on that is always, even now looking at them on the screen, is the fact is that his drawings are so minimal in the, and all throughout his career, his etchings become more and more worked and more skillful. But in the drawings, they become more minimal and sparser. And it is very interesting. It's not because they are parallel mediums. So it's actually, the drawings, they are not preparatory for an etching and vice versa. So the contrast, and you see also, you can see in the galleries, but it's also how different his approach to the medium is.
Yeah. I think that you know with Morandi you have the etching tool, which you feel intensely in his etchings, you know, through the incised line. You have his paintings where you really feel the touch of the brush on the canvas, and in the drawings this wonderful sense of the touch of the pencil onto the surface of the paper. So they're all, it's a very refined aesthetic. And also here, there's just such a wonderful sense that you're never sure whether he's drawn an object or drawn the shape around the object and the consequences of the object. They tease you endlessly. Mm-hmm. And if we go,
I think now as I want to, obviously you will we will describe and talk about it, but I think it's that one. I just wanted to say something that all is your works, but is, I always find it very poetic and very very beautiful. But particularly this series of they are particularly beautiful, interesting, and moving. And I think it reflects very much also the passion that you have, and it's very difficult to describe also because of the quality of the objects are so precise and so nice. I mean, even sometimes can't find a better word, but also it's a fact, it's actually the poetic, and also you they go around, alongside your poems, but also they are so poetic. And this is something is a trademark of all your works. I remember things that I've seen before, and it's especially for the sculpture, there is the etchings and your prints are much more sort of stronger. They actually is they're very delicate. Your sculptures, and they look fabulous, especially. So I hope most of the people that are here this evening, then they will come, or if they haven't been before, to come and see them for real on in the galleries, because also they take out a completely different different feeling and a different idea. I actually I was opening the museum a few days ago, and as with the light coming through, and actually there's another conversation that's not only with the Morandi, but also with the outside world there in front of the window. So there's all they're in a domestic setting, even if it's a gallery. So they talk to each other as well. But anyway, I'll let you describe them better. And
well, I think you've done an amazing job. I'm very touched. These sculptures are kind of like, I suppose, almost like a sort of a metaphor for the ideas that one holds in one's head. And, you know, I suppose, you know, this was, you know, very much around sense of family and relationships and things like that. In a lot of the sculptures and in some of the prints, the asthma ventilator appears. And I suppose, you know, that's a reference in part to the fact that the pandemic, you know, COVID is something that affects the lungs very much. And I suppose, you know, when you're of a certain age and you have a certain condition, I did feel a little bit apprehensive at the beginning of the pandemic. I made these little miniature builder's palettes for some of them, you know, as if it was almost like a world, you know, waited to be packed away. And things like that.
Could you actually maybe also describe it a little bit, if you haven't seen them, they maybe it's quite misleading what they're made of, and as, and also the process and of achieving them, because it's a mix of a completely built and cast and real objects and.
Yeah, well. I mean, for example, here there's a traveling alarm clock, which actually is cast in bronze. And I'd made it a long time ago, and it hadn't worked in the piece I was making. So it just became, you know, I don't throw things like this
away. Recycling.
Yeah. And, you know, so that was cast in lots of different pieces and then assembled. The asthma ventilator is cast from an object. The picture frame, I made lots of picture frames, which I then cast, took molds from, and then cast in plaster. And then the other two objects are, you know, the kind of breath coming out of the ventilator. That's been made, modelled from a party balloon that is beginning to lose its air, and things like this. So there's a lot of you know, playful activity. And maybe we should go on to the etchings.
Yes, especially I'm very slightly already conscious about the time. As always, we listen to you. I mean, I always
I'll try and move a bit quick.
Slowly.
I'll try and move a bit quick. Well, this was a set of four etchings that I made, you know, where in a way I was playing with the objects I'd made and almost like setting them up as if, you know, this was my imagined studio. I suppose, you know, that they do have a kind of sense of an internal world. If we go on to the next. Mm-hmm.
Next again?
Yeah, and again. And again. So, you know, they were, just go back a second.
Exactly. I think
yeah, that's it.
Because...
You know, and so, you know, the furniture, you know, they were all objects that I made in miniature and things like that. And then once I'd taken photographs, they were then reworked in the computer and reassembled, and in some cases, bits from some photographs collaged into another. So they're very much, you know, very playfully made and made over quite a long period of time. I think I worked on this set of four over about, you know, 4 or 5 months. And if we go on to the next slide, it also has, you know, Morandi is not the only man in my life. And I thought it was interesting to show this lovely lithograph by Alberto Giacometti, where, in a way, you know, Giacometti uses his own studio as a kind of, almost like as a landscape. And so here he is sort of drawing his various sculptures going. And then the next one is a late painting by Philip Guston that I think about a lot, where in a way he's kind of like, you know, assembling all this stuff, you know, that kind of constitutes the artist's life. And here he is smoking in bed, you know, with cakes about to be eaten or chips and all his boots and lights. And they have an enormous sense of anxiety about them, which is something that I think I share. I certainly experienced through lockdown. We'll just move.
Sorry?
I think we can just move fairly quickly through these. next one.
But no, I think here that you were talking earlier about the sense of anxiety. This is the fact is that, yes, the is all very on the verge of falling apart. And then,
yes,
despite a very it is very interesting to see, especially when you see them for real. It's the idea of they're very reassuring because they are small objects like a toy, or like a doll's house kind of things. But also, it's actually the fact that things they can be falling apart very quickly, and there is that sense of instability, like the chair that's going to be falling off any minute now.
Yeah, and in fact, if we go on to the next slide.
Sorry.
Yeah, that way.
Much more. Know,
this is completely the antithesis of you know, Morandi, but it was something. I did think of this raft very much like a builder's palette. And I suppose I was also thinking a lot that we were, you know, somehow Britain was a little bit like the raft of the Medusa in the epidemic. I kind of in a way felt that, you know, it was all a bit of a disaster. So there was a kind of echo of that. But once again, I suppose the way that although I've seen this painting in the flesh a few times, it was a small postcard I had that was in my studio. And so I then kind of, in a way, saw it in miniature. And how are we doing? Let's just go, we can just go through these. These are other works. And here, and of course, in a way,
this is the other influences.
You know, this wonderful painting in the Estorick Collection of De Chirico, you know, they are incredibly unsettling and disorientating images, and they were things that I drew upon.
But also, the interesting is that you picked this painting. There actually is a. It's got the familiar elements of the biscuits. Obviously, this is for Italians, probably more than British people. These are biscuits, they probably still exist, and they've been, and it's, so there is the unsettling words or the different angles, but also the biscuits that which was to the Chirico was given during his time in the hospital in Ferrara. So, but it is a picture that you picked with some very mundane objects as well.
Yeah.
Also, is the exhibition here or the display of Paul's the Estorick is with all our etchings, but also there are some poems and so there is a box that is for sale. Maybe it should be some commercial point. This is a box for sale as well as also a small catalogue that we have done. But I think to encapsulate the idea of your work, I think it would be nice if you could read one or two poems and then to give also the full experience of your lockdown, I suppose.
Yeah, thank you. Okay, so I'm just going to, I think I'll just read, I'll read one to start off with. It's called A Still Life. And this is in a way the, I suppose, where we got the idea of the title of the whole show from. There's a silence stalking the streets, the sound of the city now incomplete, hardly a beat. And from this hush as never before, the sounds of swifts back from afar, flying back from Africa. 6 months on the wing, returning to nest. Listener hard, hand to ear pressed, the just heard rattle of a distant train. Now with no planes or sirens to distract, you can just hear the faintest rhythm of metal on track. A memory of a distant past, a flickering in the ribs, a still beating heart. Uncanny times, the city, volume now turned down low, muted, uncanny, like Morandi's bric-a-brac, quietly arranged in a row, or the false perspectives of a Di Chirico, whose elongated shadows fall, full of forbearing, shaping empty streets, deserted, abandoned, no one to greet, only mannequins and statues left alone in the heat. I tighten my fist and clench my teeth. Shadows of the late afternoon cling with the atmosphere of Juliet's tomb. Here in our neighbourhood, Claude, a black cat has gone missing. Don't feed him. Please stop if you're listening. It will let him remember that his home is with me. Until his return, we're just two, not three. And here, a bunch of tulips wrongly delivered, perhaps from a daughter, a brother, a lover. Can we help unite them? I call the helpline and wait in the queue. I'm free today with little to do. A message left on hold, held in the air. Please wait, our operatives are all busy in care, repeats Daphne, Charlotte, Lauren or Lizzie, or Anne, Felicity, Frances or Chrissy. I listen late into the night till my battery dies and I go dizzy. The Swifts now returning, feeding, seek out hiding and are now sleeping. Quiet, a still life. The city in lockdown like a heart in repose, or on its final beat before no one knows, and the lights slowly dim and the curtains close. So
thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I was looking at the box because I think is that you've done some books before, so it's part of also your practice. It's not only the sculptures but also the objects. So it's a, this is love for things, for objects itself, for books, and this beautiful box that that we have, and is part of what you like doing as an artist, isn't it?
Yeah, so you know, I like the idea of something, you know, kind of contained, and it obviously refers to you know, Marcel Duchamp's Box in a Valise, which is, you know, one of my, I think it's an inspiring piece of work, made when Duchamp was in Paris under Nazi occupation. And, you know, he pretended to be a cheese salesman in order to get the work out. And this multiple by Joseph Beuys, which again is a, an interesting object.
And that is some of your, again, there's the full as well.
It's the perfect gift for Christmas.
Absolutely. And it's,
And there's the, yes, the sense of elongated shadows that I mentioned in the poem.
And as well, that is on display in the museum, and some of the drawings that we've been mentioning earlier as well. And is and this is the other smaller gift for Christmas is your the small handbook about your display.
Yeah, and this also includes a piece that I wrote on one of the Morandi etchings in the collection for Art in Print a few about 18 months ago. So we've republished that.
Paul, thank you. It's always fascinating, and it's I think it's probably a bit too late to get another poems in. I think I will check if we have some, if I can see if we have some questions or not. But otherwise, maybe while we just wrap it up, maybe you would like to, do you mind reading another poem?
I'll read one.
Leave if anybody's got some questions, you can type them up and then I can read them afterwards.
I'll read one very short one. And it's called A Walk in the Woods. This evening, and in a way, this was very much informed by the way that, you know, we had our daily exercise through lockdown. This evening, it's not for passing the time, I said, as for a would-be poet in their room or shed, content until the call to bed and words left scattered and unread. It's unsettling. It's not for the mere passing of time, more as marking time, picking out a rhyme and punctuating the day with events either real or dreamt, and shaping them, giving them order in order to make some sense. Out walking in the woods, do you, she said, prefer the dawn to dusk? I answer, one is full of potential, the other regret. I raise my flag like a great pretender and offer to you my complete surrender. Once more round the block and love me tender. And was it better then or now, I ask, knitting your arm in mine, a gentle clasp, and adjusting our pace, freewheeling, entwined, until together we form a rhyme, our shoes now stepping out in time, and I reach the question, how it all began. Am I still recognizable from what I was then? You, dressed classically in dark attire, are still the object of my desire. Walking amongst the trees, these thoughts, we're only marks upon the page, a sequence of words and spaces, sounds cut by silences scattered amongst the leaves, traces. That's it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And it's again, there's I don't think we got any questions, but also I would like thank you again for doing the display with me and also having this chat this evening. And to everybody, thank you very much. And hopefully you will be able to come and see the exhibition if you haven't done before. And we are the displays on until the 19th of December. Thank you very much.